I want to welcome everyone to the first Tuesday today. Thank you for being here. If you're viewing, thank you for viewing and watching today. I especially want to thank you all for being here because, one, it's pouring down rain, and two, it's a voting day. So traffic is messed up everywhere. So thank you for being here. I appreciate it, all the support we have. So thank you. Today we're going to have Debbie Watts. She is a local historian and author. She also wrote the Ryman Diaries, where his captain and Betty Ryman talk about their lives. And Debbie does Betty Ryman in the play. And she's going to talk a little bit today about how you take a historical character and how you bring them to life, how you portray that in a first person. And so that's what she'll be doing. I just want to give you a quick update on our first Tuesdays. April the 5th, I'm trying to get Dr. Busey, Carol Busey, the county historian, to come back. And remember, she did a first piece on education in Nashville, and I wanted to come back and do the second part of that. We have Richard Condon on May 3rd. He is the director of the Franklin Battlefield Trust, and he's going to come and talk to us about the Battle of Franklin and the efforts down there to preserve. And June 7th, Tom Vickstrom, he's the general manager for the Hermitage Hotel, and he's going to come and talk to us about the history of the Hermitage Hotel. So that's kind of what's coming up. Remember, it's 12:30 to 1:30 here in the Commons Room, and we appreciate everyone being here. And with that, I'll turn it over to Debbie Watts.
Thank you. Well, thank you, Ken, and thank all of you for being here today. One of the things that I've learned most about being a presenter in this kind of situation is I've learned to be flexible. And I've learned to be flexible because of technology, which is here to help us. So that being the case, I had saved a piece that I was going to show you last today. But it's actually the piece that you see first when you come to our play, The Ryman Diaries. And believe me, I'm going to make sure that each and every one of you has memorized our performance schedule for the spring, summer, and fall before you leave today. You cannot leave out that door unless you can recite to me on the way out where you can see us and when. All that being said, I'm going to reverse the order of my presentation just a little bit to show you the film insert that we are using at the beginning of The Ryman Diaries. Actually, that's not exactly true. The very first scene that you see is Betty Ryman as an 80-year-old woman. I know it's hard for you to believe that I could become 80 years old before your very eyes. I know it's a stretch, but I do manage to do it. And I come out first as the 80-year-old Betty, and then the rest of the play is told as a flashback. So after Betty's first scene, this is what you see.
Thank you.
For those who walked in during the little opening film, welcome. And I'm Debbie Watts, and this is Taking History to the Stage. And even as I say that, thank you, Cliff, even as I say that, I feel that my first slide is very intimidating to me, because my first slide says, who am I to say? Who am I to be here today? Who am I to have the nerve to write a play? Who am I to think that I can present a page of history and do it accurately and in an entertaining way? But if you're interested in writing for historical theater, you have to kind of overlook who are you and just forge ahead. Because what I found out after I got into my research is that there was so little written about my character, Betty Ryman, that I realized that I had a certain amount of freedom. Now, I didn't want to tell anything about Betty that wasn't true, but I wanted to also make the most of what I could find about her. And what I knew in my heart and what this experience validated for me was that people are people, whether they lived in the 19th century, the 20th century, the 21st century, and they have the same wants and needs as we have today. They fight with their husbands. They have issues with raising children. They live through wars. They lived through disease. And so that gave me a certain amount of comfort in what I was writing. If I had had a smaller group today, I was going to have everybody tell your name and what you hope to get from today's session. But since we're a large group and I'm tickled to death that each and every one of you are here, I might just ask the group, is there anyone of you today who maybe you're already actively in pursuit of writing a historical play? Are there any of those among us, or are you getting ready to write something? Or yes, sir, I met you earlier. Could you tell us your name, please?
John Collins.
John. Mr. John, what are you working on? What are you writing?
A book of Shackles of the Mind. It's a history of a 400-year-old family at different epochs in our journey of 400 years.
Uh-huh.
That what they have done to contribute to making America what it is today.
Oh, wow. Well.
And I have documentation through genealogy and through history about this family that came to America in first 1535 to 1565.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Well, Godspeed with that, and I want to be updated on when it's out and where I can see it and where I can get it. Anybody else writing anything? You know, it doesn't have to be that. I know that was probably intimidating to anyone who might be writing. It sounds like a very ambitious project, and best of luck to you there. So, therefore, if nobody else wants to talk about yourself, Mr. Ken, are you writing something?
I'm not really writing, but when I reenact, we have to do a lot of I want to start doing first person, because I can talk a lot about it as Ken, but I want to talk. I have a few persons that were actually there that I can do research on, determine, you know, like you do, what's their outlook, what do they think, how they feel about certain things. And so I think this will be interesting from that perspective for me, you know.
I'm glad that Ken, and we'll hear from you in just one second, but I'm glad that he mentioned the writing in first person. Because if you're writing something in diary form, you have to stay in first person. And that may sound obvious to most of us, but believe me, eighth graders who are doing this project along with me and who are taking up the challenge of writing a diary as a character, they will slip into that third person narrative and not even realize it. And guess what? They don't want to proofread. I know that may come as a shock to you, but eighth graders would rather just publish it just like it is. I mean, after all, it tricked off my lips, so it must be gold. They don't want to rewrite and proofread and edit. They just don't want to do it. Yes, ma'am. You wanted to tell us a little bit about what you're involved with?
I'm writing, with the help of Ken, a nonfiction. It's a bit of a legal drama. It's based on a Supreme Court case that happened in Tennessee in 1917. It's about two African-American boys who were convicted of assaulting and raping a white girl in near Pulaski, Tennessee.
Uh-huh.
The greater story is they made it to trial. They weren't lynched. in spite of great efforts to do so.
Yes, ma'am.
And it really just tells a story of that era, the politics of that era, and how they were caught up in a political storm, mm-hmm. even though they were most likely innocent. Mm-hmm. They were caught up in a political storm of what was the greater good for the state mm-hmm. and their
Fascinating.
It's a very hard story to tell.
Yes, I would imagine so, and best of...
Emotional.
Yes, Godspeed in your project, Godspeed in your mission. I hope you can hear something that we say today that would, they'll give you a nugget of some kind of gold that you can take with you. Back to what I'm here to share with you then. What I have done, as Ken said, and by the way, when you do start that big historical theater project, let me tell you how valuable the Nashville Library Archives. And Ken and his staff are there to help you, and it's just a friendly, warm place. I didn't feel so alone in writing this when I could come down here and just delve into the books and see what I could find. And I think that for any writer facing a blank page, whether it's writing a historical drama, a novel, a play, that blank page day after day can get pretty lonely. So one of the secrets that I have found to sticking with a writing project is to find a way to be able to be with other people throughout the ordeal. Because I'm a disciplined writer and I get up at 4:30 to write. So I've written for a couple of hours before the world gets started. And sometimes on a given day, that's all I cared to do. But 2 hours of loneliness, you in that blank page, is 2 long hours. That's really 2 long hours. So whenever you can surround yourself with friendly people, like at the library archives or down at the coffee shop, so that you can just go and talk to human beings for a while and then get back to work, I urge you don't hibernate and don't hermitize yourself while you're trying to do this monumentous thing. Well, back to whatever credential I might have in order to be here today. I have written a play, and some of you have been in our audience. Raise your hand if you've been in our audience. That'll make me feel good. Oh my goodness, look at all those theater-going people. My play is called The Ryman Diaries. All my life, and by the way, I was born and raised in Nashville, Tennessee. I'm one of the few who's been born here and stayed here all my life. But all of my life, I've been drawn to the Cumberland River. My first gig on the Cumberland River was as a singer and piano player on the Belle Carroll Riverboat Company. I went up and down the Cumberland 2 summers in a row. And then, of course, I worked at Opryland, and lo and behold, our stage was right next to the river, so there I was again. And when my tourists would come on board the Belle Carroll or see me at Opryland, I would expect them to ask me about Roy Acuff and Ernest Tubb and Loretta Lynn. But you know the person that they asked for about the most often? Captain Ryman. And I thought I would file that in my brain. And I said to myself, one of these days, whether you want to call it a bucket list or whatever, I said, one of these days I'm going to do some research and write about Captain Ryman's connection to all of this country music empire that has sprung up and that feeds us and helps us be what we are. So finally that day came, and I didn't wait till I retired, and I'm glad I didn't. Because if I had, now I've learned how lazy you can get after you retire. But about 2 summers before I retired, I just said, nope, I'm not waiting, this is the summer. And I came down here and I worked with Ken and them, and I went over to the state library also, and I started reading. But what fascinated me most was Betty, the wife, because I've known all my life that behind every great man, there's a great woman. Except I want to alter that just a little bit for you today, because I think that not behind every great man, beside every great man, there's a woman standing there. And in Betty's case, sometimes she prodded him a little bit with an electric shock to get him to do things. But I want to take the first part of my session today for you to get to know her, because later in the session today, hopefully, you will use what I did with Betty as a model to get started on how you might create a character of your own from someone who really lived. What I did find out about Betty in the early days of my research is that there just wasn't much written about her. Now, that didn't shock me, because they lived during Victorian times, and during Victorian times, the wife stayed at home, she raised the children, she cooked the meals, and she kept house. And, you know, she didn't want her name in the paper unless it was in the society column throwing a tea party. And that was about the extent of Betty's involvement in the newspaper archives that I found. There was a write-up when the first daughter got married, because by that time it was 1892 and Betty and Tom Ryman were one of the wealthiest couples in Nashville. And therefore, they had begun building their house on Market Street. And if you're ever on 2nd Avenue going away from town and you see that big estate up on the hill that's got the great view of the Cumberland and it's got the black iron fence around it, that was the Ryman place. Now it's right next to the radio satellites and you see the big dishes sitting there. So if you're driving down 2nd Avenue and you go past that place, that was the Ryman home. He wanted to build the house so that Betty could sit on the front porch and see the boats and see the traffic. So that's one of the pieces that you're going to hear me do today, the little piece about that. But back to my story about Betty, there just wasn't that much about her. So that gave me a certain amount of freedom, because when I found that there weren't a lot of books, there was a family file here at the archives, and there was a family file at the State Library Archives about the Ryman family. But the fewer books that there are written about whoever it is that you want to write about, the more freedom you have, because you don't have to answer to as many authorities. And you want to be accurate, so you want to read everything that's out there. It's kind of like selecting a topic for your master's thesis. You don't want to write about Robert Browning, because there's too much that you've got to read in order to write about him. I wrote about Iris Murdoch, who was a 20th century author, and there was only this much. So I felt like, oh wow, you know what? I might even become the Nashville authority on Betty Ryman. And I'll tell you this, and you may laugh at it, you may be in awe of it, you may not care, you may think I'm making it up, but it's the truth. One night, I went to sleep having written a few notes in my journal. I always keep a journal on my nightstand. And I woke up in the middle of the night because I had gone to sleep having hit an impasse. I woke up in the middle of the night, I grabbed my journal, I headed downstairs. I knew that I was probably up for the duration, so I went ahead and put the pot of coffee on. And I sat down and I started writing with my left hand. Now, I'm not left-handed, but guess who was? Betty Ryman. And it was the most intimate scene in the whole play. So you can take that with, I'll do that monologue for you today, so you'll know which scene I'm talking about. But I don't know if she visited me. If she did, I want her to come back. I'd like her to come again. I got to know Tom and Betty quite well on this journey, and I like the story that we told. I like the truth that they lived. And so I found myself really enjoying from that point on, especially what I was doing. So what I'm going to do a couple of scenes for you. Now, when you come and see the Ryman Diaries, you will know that we tell the story as if we're reading from our diaries. Tom has his own diary, and I'm so glad he's not here today, because I get to do all the talking, Ken. When he's here, I have to share the airtime with him, and I didn't want to today, so you get all of me today. But each of us has, as our major prop on stage, our own diary. Now, this is the same diary that I started writing the script in, and I just kept it, because it's my good luck charm on stage. And this is the diary that I use on stage. Notice that I use the appropriate writing utensils, that I tried to be as authentic as possible. And we'll talk about all of this as we have time. How authentic do you need to be on stage as you're telling a story, especially if it happens to be in a different century? It's a very important piece to the puzzle. Just a note or two about the little opening film. What you saw there was our little family anecdote accompanying the most dramatic event in young Betty's life, and that is being interrupted during playtime by a thing called the Battle of Franklin. They were young girls, she and her sister Alabama. Depicted in the film was a young lady from my eighth grade class playing young Betty, and then the smaller girl was my grandbaby daughter, and the mom was my daughter, and the little boy in the scene was my grandson. So we depicted that just as I read it, that they were playing together, had a little neighbor boy that was a playmate. They heard the cannon fire, and just as they were running out of the house, the cannonball came in the window. But it didn't destroy the house. Don't know why, but when they went back, it was still in one piece. But we'll get to that. Let's see. I'm going to skip around. I'm going to do my favorite scenes today. Is that okay with y'all? I'll do my favorite monologues. One of the things that makes a great love story in real life and in fiction is the old tried and true opposites attract. You can't fight it. I don't care how hard you try. How many of you are married or in a relationship with someone who's your opposite? You don't have to confess anything, but it's just as true today as it was then. Now, here was Tom Ryman. He was raised on the river. He learned the fishing business from his dad. Some folks in Nashville called him a river rat. They called him a river rat. He was rough. He was crude. And here was Betty Baugh, a debutante, being raised in Franklin, Tennessee. Her father was the postmaster. She had a good upbringing. They had plenty. They were upper middle class. She attended private schools. So I will give you Betty's monologue after having been introduced to Tom Ryman. By the way, when she went to Franklin College, she was teamed up with a roommate named Susan Ryman. Tom's sister was her roommate at college. And so Susan's wheel started turning as soon as she met little Betty, because she knew that her brother needed some culture in his life. So she and her mother started trumping up on him. He didn't have a chance. He really didn't. He had three females working for his undoing, and so one will do you in, but he had three. So this is what, this is Betty's take after a weekend in the country, going to the Ryman home, being driven there by young Tom, who was Susan's brother, who had just come in from a shipping trip up and down the Cumberland. His mother made him go get these two girls at school, bring them to the Ryman home for the weekend. So here's Betty's little take on meeting Tom Ryman for the first time. October 2nd, 1865. Dear Diary, this weekend I met the most ill-mannered boy. What? He's crude, rough, does not use good grammar at all. He's got dirt under his fingernails, and he's unshaven, and he smells like river water. But he's the brother of my very best friend, and Susan says that she and her mother owe everything to him. And I believe there must be a great deal of good in a brother who would sacrifice his own personal life and hygiene to provide for his mother and sisters. Susan insisted that I sit next to him in the carriage on the way to the Ryman home, and I was so uncomfortable in his presence. Out of the corner of my eye, I could see that he stared at me the whole time. And when we got back to the dorm on Sunday night, Susan said, "He likes me." Oh. By the way, do you like Betty's dress? Let me tell you, if you're writing historical theater, and you're delving into the 18th, 19th, and 20th centuries, especially American literature, there is a fashion house called Recollections. You go on their website and you simply click on whatever century you want, and the dresses will pop up at you. And I just clicked until I got Betty's whole wardrobe. By the way, when you come to the play, you will see that she has 10 costume changes throughout the play. So it's a fashion show. So if you've got fashionista friends, bring them with you, because it's a fun experience just seeing what all she's gonna wear. Now, after a respectable time, the courtship blossomed into something else, and I will share with you a scene from August of 1867. Look at all y'all in the catbird seat who've already seen the play. You're smiling because you know what's coming. August 1867. What a terrible summer. Mommy and I went to care for some children who'd come down with the typhoid, and then I got it. I'm glad Mommy didn't. Everything's just hazy in my mind. I just remember burning up and seeing Mommy sit by my bedside. But I don't know what's real and what was a dream. This morning, my fever finally broke, and so Mommy let me sit in my chair next to my window. That same window that I used to watch the soldiers from. Seems like such a long time ago. Anyway, I reached up to stroke my hair. Y'all need to use your imagination about my hair. I reached up to stroke my hair, and it was gone. Mom and Sis cut it. They said it made me cooler. But Susan's been to see me every day, they say, and they tell me that Tom has asked Mommy's permission to marry me. Said he whispered the question, and I said yes. I must have been delirious with fever. Well, he'll just have to ask again. No respectable young woman should be held to saying yes while delirious with fever. And we'll have to have a long engagement. I've got to grow my hair back, and I've got to make my wedding dress and dresses for Mommy and Sis and Susan. Oh, me, married. That means I guess I'd be spending a lot of time on that riverboat. Oh, where's my Bible? I want to read that story about Ruth. How does it go now? Let me see. Whither thou goest, I will go. Whither thou lodgest, I will lodge. Thy people shall be my people, and thy God, my God. So, we know that they did get married. They got married on February 3rd, 1869. Just had their anniversary. I called that Tom Dolan on the phone to wish him a happy anniversary, and he forgot it. Now, how real is that? And we're not even married in real life. I said, the least you could have done is remember this anniversary. I don't know. They did get married. They proceeded to live on the boat, just like she feared. But guess what? She loved it, and she was good at it. She was good at meeting people, and she was a great cook, and she was good at making the other ladies feel comfortable. You know, traveling in those days up and down the Cumberland River, it was not like being on a luxury cruise liner. It was crude and rough, as Betty described. And one of the things that she was the most shocked about was that Tom had the nerve to suggest that she would have to play cards with the other ladies. And she says, what would my professors at Franklin Episcopal say about that? But guess what? She enjoyed playing cards, and she was good at poker. I did read that. That's documented. She said, you know, I'll draw the line. I'll cook for them, I'll make dessert for them, and I'll play cards with them. But I draw the line at smoking cigars, because some of their guests on the riverboats, the ladies smoked cigars. And she thought that was terribly racy. But she did enjoy playing cards. Now, you're going to want to, sooner or later, are any of you musicians, songwriters, play music, like music? like to write music someday if you could? Sooner or later, you might be faced with, I need to put some music with this story. Now, I didn't have to twist my own arm because I'm a musician and I'm a composer. So we wound up, Tom and I together, writing 7 original songs for the show. So we get to legitimately call The Ryman Diaries a musical. And you, when you're putting music to a historical piece, obviously you'll want to pay attention to phraseology, you know. Now, I stand up here before you and I say that, but who knows what the biggest hit on Broadway is right now today? A little show called Hamilton. It's about the Hamilton-Burr pistol duel, Alexander Hamilton. They wrote the music in rap and hip-hop. So forget anything I may tell you today and go with the way they did it. Now, all of that is to say that you're going to want a certain amount of authenticity to whatever music you put with your show. So I thought that for one song today, I'll do real quick. It's Betty's she's homesick. She's married this ruffian, this river rat, and she's feeling like, what have I gotten myself into? And the biggest problem in her life is the fact that he told her from the first that this river is my first love. Now, if you want to put up with that, if you want to face life as the second fiddle, then let's get married. So he was honest with her. He didn't try to lead her on. But that's a difficult one for us ladies to deal with, isn't it? Being second? We don't want to be second. And I dare say that Betty probably didn't want to be second either. But she deals with it. She shares with the audience her feelings. See if I remember my own song. River flows, I wanna go wherever he goes. He's like no man I've ever known before. He loves me, but he loves that river more. And love is like a river, and it flows forever. To the deep blue sea, he'll go with or without me. He loves me, but he loves that river more. Now, river, if you were a woman, I know just what I'd do. I'd show him I could love him twice as good as you. Loving him the way I do means I have to love you too. And love, like a river flows, I wanna go wherever he goes. He's like no man I've ever known before. He loves me, but he loves that river more. He loves that river, loves the river more. Thank you. Oh, you're too kind. But that was, I had to think about how she would feel about what she'd been told by her beloved. And then I just wrote the song. I wish I could tell you there's a shortcut, but I don't know what it is. Now I want to do the scene that Betty came to me and I wrote it left-handed. Y'all want to see that scene? Okay. All right. So, in every marriage, there's probably a midlife crisis. Tom and Betty had earned enough money. They were one of Nashville's wealthiest couples at the time. He had built a home because their oldest child was ready to start school. And they had raised several children on the boat. In fact, they had six by then. They didn't move to dry land with the kids until the oldest one was 6 years old. So those little babies grew up on that river. They were river rats like Tom. And there are scenes in which we're chasing the kids all over the boat, and Tom talks to kids that aren't there. And I want you to come and see Tom Dolan, because he is really the professional heart and soul of this production. When I met Tom, he and another theater group were working on a big full-blown musical about Captain Ryman. And my little play is just a two-person thing with little simple songs that we play on our own instruments. But when I saw that Lakewood Theater was putting together a show about Tom Ryman, I thought, I better contact those people and let them know that I'm working on the same thing, so that when they premiere and they see me on the front row, they won't think that I went home and copied their show. So I contacted Tom Dolan, and some months went by, and I knew that I hadn't seen any more promotional material about that show. Well, to make a long story short, that show never happened. It didn't pan out. And so I called Tom immediately, and I said, you've groomed yourself to become Tom Ryman. Would you consider doing my little play with me? And before I finished my question, he said yes. And so we got together. But he's really the consummate professional in this little enterprise. By the way, he works on the election commission, so he's tied up today. And that's how you have me, but without him. But I want you to come just to see him, because he really does become Captain Ryman before your very eyes. It's really amazing. But I'll do one more scene, and then we're going to talk about your careers as writers. This scene, Betty is undergoing a little bit of, as I said, a midlife crisis. She's become a little bit insecure. After all, Tom kind of kicked her off the boat, put her in this house, and he's keeping on going up and down the Cumberland having all these adventures, and she's stuck with the housework and the kids. And so I'll set the stage that way for you. Actually, I'm going to do two scenes together. This first one is May of 1885. Do you know that ever since we started this play, this is the original pen, I haven't lost it? I think that's remarkable, Ken. What do you think about that? 2 years with the same pen. So I just wanted to interject that. Here we go. We're living in the house now. May 1885. My Tom, he got the contract to build the pontoon bridge across the Cumberland while the new bridge is being built. And I've never seen a man throw himself into his work the way he has. In fact, he's working too hard. I wish I could think of a way to slow him down. But now that he's at home every night, he gets up before daylight, and he hitches up that carriage, and the crew all the way down to the dock can hear that gentle clip-clop of the horse's hooves on the stone street as he goes to work. Oh, the crew members down there, they love my Tom. Now, the funniest thing happened the other day. There was this high-born lady in a carriage, and she instructed her driver to just drive straight through without paying the toll. She was heard to say in her most haughty voice, "Drive on, James, drive on." Oh, if she only knew how we'd made fun of her at the dinner table. And it's even become a joke down at the dock. When Tom needs to get the crew moving, he'll mimic that lady and say, "Drive on, James, drive on." Oh, it's so much fun to work with Tom on the river. I miss it. My days are filled with the house and the children and the menu planning. Oh, the children dread seeing me go to the produce market this time of year, because they know it means only one thing. Everybody grab a knife and start peeling and chopping. Why, they know how much I love to put up fruit and vegetables. I just love to sit on our big front porch with a big bowl full of apples to peel and quarter while I listen to the traffic on the river. Other day I was observing the goings-on down there. Oh, I forgot to tell y'all. I got myself a little spyglass so I could keep an eye on the captain. And I caught a glimpse of that businessman from Louisville, the one who's putting in the railroad. He was meeting with my Tom down on the riverfront. And he had a woman with him that he called his daughter. I don't know what she was, but what I do know is I caught her flirting with my Tom behind that fancy Japanese fan of hers. Brazen hussy. Well, I'm going to do something about this. Mirror, mirror, in my hand, who's the fairest in the land? Oh, it's not me, and there's nothing fair about it. But still, I wonder why do men get better looking when they turn a little gray? Then, girls, they've got you where they want you, in the kitchen all day. He's my captain, I'm his first mate, but if I'm gonna be his last, it's time to wake up and smell the hazelnut pie and do something fast. Could I be Red Hot Betty? I wonder if I'm ready, beguiling and bewitching. Time to get me out of this kitchen. I'll trade in my rolling pin for a brand new chapeau. Lose this apron, this dreary matron's gotta go. I wanna be so hot, I'll steam up a captain fricassee. Red Hot Betty, Red Hot Betty, that's me. But she goes behind her little dressing screen, and in the course of 2 short minutes, she comes out Red Hot Betty. Does that make you want to come and see the play? Well, I hope so. I hope so. Because it was that very night that she dragged him, I mean invited him, to go to a tent meeting with her to listen to a certain Reverend Sam Jones from Cartersville, Georgia. Now, he said, I'm not going, I'm not going, I'm putting my foot down, I'm telling all my friends and business associates not to go either, and I'm just not going, I'm going to stop this nonsense. I don't need any preacher to tell me about Jesus. Why, Jesus and I have been friends all our lives. He grew up on the river just like I did. I don't need any red hot tent meeting in the hot summertime Nashville to hear a minister. And then he goes, well, now if I do go, I'll heckle that preacher. That's a legend. He really didn't go to heckle the preacher. In fact, guess who the first person to answer the altar call that night was? Tom Ryman. Because whatever Tom Ryman did, he did all the way. And then he told all his friends what had happened to him at the tent meeting. And the very next morning, he started raising money to build the Union Gospel Tabernacle, which later became, as you know, the Ryman Auditorium. He would never allow for it to be named the Ryman as long as he lived. That touches me. I can barely tell that part without getting choked, but he wouldn't. He wouldn't allow for it to be named after him till he passed away. And then the day after the funeral, the trustees and the board voted unanimously to name it the Ryman Auditorium. So that's the gist of our story. Now, I want to talk to you just about a couple of things. Don't y'all hate PowerPoints? I hate them. Here we go. This is going to be quick because I do not like them. We've already talked about who am I to say. How do I choose a subject? How do I tell the story? How do I write authentic dialogue? History versus entertainment. There's a dilemma. Are you writing a history book? Sort of. But you get their attention by entertaining them with it. There is an authority on this subject, and his name is Dr. Charles Deamer. He is a professor at Oregon State. Mr. Bob, had you ever heard of Charles Deamer?
No.
He says you have to engage their emotions first. And then, well, I know this from teaching school. entertain them first and then teach them something. And then when they go home and tell their parents they didn't do anything today except have fun in Miss Watt's class, you'll know that they learned something. But yes, you do have a responsibility to history, but yes, you want to be entertaining with it. And identifying your audience. You have to identify your audience. Right out of the chute, we found out that our audience was consisting of, obviously, people who liked history, people who liked the history of Nashville, people who liked music, students, people, we had a lot of church audiences with the connection with Reverend Sam Jones. And by the way, if you come and see us this spring, summer, and fall, we have added a Reverend Sam Jones to our cast, and he is awesome. He's the music director at my church, and he just becomes the Reverend Sam Jones. Why, we're expecting altar call at the show every night. You know, and we might even be doing the community a great service by having him there. Choosing a subject, I won't belabor this, you know what my subject was. Your subject is what you want it to be. Okay, there's lots of ways to get started telling the story. You can use a timeline, a storyboard, a graphic organizer, which brings me to my graphic organizer. Take a look. I gave you two sheets of paper. And no, I'm not going to make you take a test, and you're not going to have to write anything. But if you choose to, when you leave here today, you might want to consider the way that I've laid things out for you to help you get started. The way that I wrote my first journal entry as Betty Ryman, I made a list. I made a two-column list. On one side of my page, I listed the most significant events in her life that I had researched and found. And then on the other side, I wrote three emotions that she might have felt about each one of those events in her life. And then, being a girl, I just projected myself into how I would feel about those, and then I proceeded to write. Now, they spoke and they phrased things a little bit differently in the 19th century, and it helped me as I was writing it to think about the Nashville and Franklin accent a little bit, as I hope I'm delivering accurately in the show. I don't feel that I have that much of a Southern accent. However, when we're doing a different play, by the way, Mr. Ken, when we go to San Diego, we're doing the Life and Times of John and Lily Spreckles. That's the play we're doing out there. But they were an influential couple in San Diego. And so when we go to San Diego, people will walk up to me and say, talk for me, talk for me. And I'll say, that'll be a $20 ticket and you can hear me talk tonight at the Spreckles Theater, if you really want to hear me talk. But it helped me to envision Betty. If I wrote, as I wrote, I thought about her accent, and you got to say it out loud when you write it. You got to practice and you got to say it out loud. That'll keep you from lapsing into that third person thing that we're all so concerned about. You don't want to tell the audience, well, I'm going to read from her diary, and then suddenly you're narrating it in third person. The audience is going to go, wait a minute, I thought she said she was going to read the diary. Oh, do you like my little terminology there, Mr. Bob? Here's a term you can use, history versus entertainment. I call it histainment. I also call it historism. You know, Nashville's enjoying a great big tourism boom right now, and part of it is what we have to offer in the way of entertainment. And we've had audiences from Ontario and Toronto and the Midwest who tell us that, number one, they'd never been to a two-person play. And so, plus they'd say, talk for me. So I guess that's an intro to getting them to the show. Charles Deamer, the gentleman that I mentioned, being the foremost historical theater writer, and he teaches this in his classes at Oregon State, says, we want our audience to feel our material first and understand it second. So what I tried to get the audience to do was to feel for Betty. And I saw part of it in your faces, either that or you just felt sorry for me here today. I'm not sure, but I thought I saw in your faces that you felt for her a little bit. And we all know a lot of famous people have said these lines, history's written by the winners. Challenges. Insufficient information. Boy, I thought there was very little about Betty Ryman. When I got out to San Diego and started trying to find things about Lily Spreckles, there was less than what there was about Betty Ryman. So what that taught me was that these two ladies living in the 19th century, they knew their place, and their place was in the home, and so it was good if they weren't in the newspaper headlines. They considered themselves lucky if they weren't. And then, of course, you've got to be mindful of your dialogue, and you want to do a little historical name dropping. You know, when she says, "Oh, my children dread seeing me go to the produce market," in the play, I say the produce market down on Market Street, because I want to throw names and places in that were real in their lives, and that's what you're going to want to throw in, real literal places and people. Graphic organizers. That brings me to my graphic organizer. Look at my little blank sheet there under that informative sheet. This is a sheet that you can use to get yourself started on this kind of a project. On one side, as I told you, on one side, list your historical events that were the most significant events in your subject's life. Now, you might have to do a little reading first to find out what those things were. And then on the right side, write just a word or two. And get yourself an emotion word bank, you know, so that you can have at your fingertips fear, anger, jealousy, contempt, you know, and then write how that character would feel about that historical event, and then write it as a diary entry. That's a one-page graphic organizer to get you started on this monumentous task. Must-reads. You got to read some history about the time that you're writing about, you know? You don't want to say that they rode to the play in a limo when the car hadn't been invented yet. You've got to be, and I'm being a little glib there, but really, you know, you don't want an anachronism to pop up in your play. It's got to be authentic, or it will not have credibility. Now, I don't know how those folks in Hamilton are getting away with having Hamilton and Burr rap their threats to one another, but I can't wait to see it. I know that I want to go. Must writes. You have to write every day. I'm sorry, but you do. Even if it's a grocery list. Because if you let days go by that you don't practice your craft, it's harder the next time. Now, while I'm a big advocate, as I said earlier, of taking breaks and being with human beings and interacting, that's important too, but you have to have quiet time to write this. Are you still a student? Where do you go to school?
I go to Big Picture High School.
Uh-huh. And do you want to write a play?
Yeah, I've written before.
You've written plays before? How do you write? Do you get your homework with the TV on?
No.
No. You have to be quiet? Okay. I guess that was it. That was my last slide. Well, that's over. I would much prefer performing monologues for you than the PowerPoint, but I just wanted to take you through those few slides so that you could see what this thing was all about. And you don't have to use this as a graphic organizer. You know, if you work better with a storyboard, Mr. Bob, how do you write best?
Early in the morning, at least 2,000 words a day of anything that's on my mind before the day gets started. And it's just usually something I've seen on TV or whatever that reminds me about my childhood or growing up, and or it's just whatever's on your mind.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Collins, how do you write best? What's best for you?
Storyboarding.
My eighth graders responded best to storyboarding, just drawing the scene. Now, I can't draw, but in that little box, I can write what I want it to say, what I want the characters to say.
I might add that I rely heavily on timelines.
Yes,
and,
timelines.
And I developed timelines in my book about how to write your memoirs, was timelines about where you live, timelines on where you work, timelines on where you went to school, timelines on pets you had, and just create a whole bunch of timelines. And then that gives you the, each one is a story in itself.
Yes. Each one is an independent story,
yes.
And I'll tell you, Tom and I, even after we started putting our heads together, we would get tripped up on things like we read and found that the night that Captain Ryman was converted happened to be a very unseasonably warm night, but the month was May. And since it was hot, we knew it was hot. Originally, we were calling it August, and it wasn't. It was May. You know how we know? Because Reverend Jones preached about mothers that night because it was Mother's Day. So Mother's Day ain't in August. So we had to go back and take out that August because there would be people in Nashville who would call us on it. If they were in our audiences, they would know. And so you have to really, really be true to what really happened. Sometimes it doesn't matter, but that time it did. Yes, ma'am?
Would you back that slide up to the...
Somebody who wants to see more of my PowerPoint.
Sure. All the certainly options, not. The timeline
thing, sure.
Yeah,
let's go back there.
On that.
Sure.
Those suggestions of different ways of... Sure.
There we go.
Mm-hmm. Telling the story. Uh-huh. Timeline. Mr. Bob uses timeline, he says. Storyboarding. Mr. Collins uses... Ken?
Debbie, I'm glad you pointed that out about research and about someone calling you out, because there are a couple of periods that I know well, and when I hear somebody trying to do first person and they can trip up on the tiniest thing and it stands out so big. So you're talking about May and August, I would know the difference in something. And so when someone's up there and they're talking about it and it hasn't happened yet, hadn't been invented yet, or they couldn't have been there, that throws the whole thing off for me as an audience. So yeah, I'm glad you said that. You've got to be correct.
Yes, and no matter how you would try to suspend that, throughout that performance that you're watching, the fact that you knew that they were tripped up, you can't get it out of your mind.
I can't get it out of my head. It's still there.
You can't. It's just there, and you can't help it.
I go through what I call photo detection skills and letter detection skills. And if you look at the photos, usually you can see think about the background. First thing I teach in my classes is you have to write 150 words of some photo that you have. But you get into it's at the park, and then they think it was a park here and there. But the other thing is the letter detecting skills. And what I do is I break that down into an Excel spreadsheet. And do it with obituaries too. Like you write down what schools they went to, who the maybe an obituary who some of the pallbearers were, or anything in the letter tells about Aunt Susie's dog is ill, mm-hmm. and the dog's name is well. But I just create a spreadsheet out and break down every detail mm-hmm. I can find, and that's what in our history memoir classes. Where at Bellevue, we teach that, and it works really well.
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
Well, I've often believe in reading some of the old letters I've had exposure to that I don't think people talk like that. Maybe they do, but I don't believe that true dialogue is what we record in a diary mm-hmm. entry or mm-hmm. a written entry. Mm-hmm. So how would you find a voice of a character in that sort of thing?
We have someone who wants to respond to that, and then I'll add something to what she wants to say.
If you're writing something and you want to find out how people actually express themselves, if you go to the Tennessee State Library and Archives and get a Supreme Court case from that year, and you can, like, just in the dialogue when people are talking on the witness stand, I think you can get a real true sense, because people say a lot of things, and so you just get a sense of what of how people express themselves,
right?
And how they refer to certain events. Mm-hmm. I found that to be helpful.
Thank you.
You know, and you also have to just consider the fact that how one person might approach a diary. You know, one person might think, "Oh well, I've got to be on my best grammar if I'm writing something down on paper." Might be different from how another person from that same era would approach the diary. Just like now. If I've got a room full of 30 eighth graders, the way that one child will approach this writing assignment will be different from the other. So you have to kind of go with your gut. I mean, you are the writer here. You're in charge. While you want your history to be accurate, It's of your creation how you make your character speak. I made Betty kind of write, she was a cultured and she had been to school. And, you know, not everybody went to college back then. And there she was at Franklin College taking penmanship and deportment and Latin. She was a Latin student. So I took all that into consideration when I had her be rather a formal debutante kind of a writer. That's how I thought she would write. So you have to kind of get to know your character yourself first. You know what, Mr. Ken, the next time we do this, this needs to be 2 hours. One hour of the modeling and then the workshop. Would you come back if we did this again? Everybody's going, oh, I'm going to have to write now. So, no, I'm going to say no. Somebody want to speak? Yes.
You talked about families wanting to own things. I have a cousin who wrote a history of the Norwegian side of my family.
Yes, sir.
Going back to Norway. And he subjected every entry to the review of the family before he printed it. and that was
very
that
good.
Was a, you know, he had to do that in order to have a market for his book. And I've read some of my grandmother's letters, and she's Danish, and she writes with a Danish accent, and my cousin is reading a postcard that my great-grandfather sent to his great-grandfather. And he's reading it and he says, well, phonetically it's correct.
You know, and let me go back quickly and say that it's not a disparaging comment that we make when we say that a family thinks that they own the history. We're families and we're human beings and we do think that. We all do think that. So, but you just have to, you know, you have to kind of just be human about it. And if you find that a book exists, you want to contact that person. And I know that particular family member had done the same thing. She had asked permission of every single family member. And I was very impressed with that. So, it's all good. I want you to enjoy your writing. I hate for our session to end, but Mr. Ken's giving me the Academy Award music playing over there, so I know I'm going to have to leave you. Let me leave you with my website that you can go and see our performance schedule. I may or may not have it on that particular business card, but it's Watts, W-A-T-T-S, D2, dot, Wix, W-I-X. Wix is a great tool. You can get free websites on Wix. Watts, D2, dot, Wix. I'm sorry, Watts D2. I can't remember my own website. Watts D2.
Wix.com.
Wix at Wix. Wix.com. /. Ryman Diaries. What Mr. Bob said right here. Yeah. What Mr. Bob said. But you'll find our performance. Yeah. 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 Was it on my first slide?
I remember it.
Here we go. Wattsd2.wix.com /forward. Ryman Diaries. You'll see our schedule for this year, our performance schedule. We also have several tabs on the webpage that you can read about my play, the Spreckles play that we're doing in San Diego as well. I have some free pictures for you of us as you leave. If anybody wants to buy a book today, I brought some of my Ryman Diaries books with me. They're on the back table. I'll meet you back there. And Mr. Ken's going to get the hook if I don't get out of the way.
Well,
Mr. Ken, thank you.
I just want to thank Debbie for being here today, and it was really good, really good. And I appreciate that very much. And my mother kept diaries from 38 to 48, and she told me I couldn't open them till I was 60, and I'm not about to do that. I've got enough concerns about my mother haunting me all day. So I'm waiting. And when I'll probably publish those. That'll get her.
Now, how close are you to 60?
2 years.
Because that's what I was teaching a group of eighth graders at Bellevue Middle School, and I tell them about back when I was your age. When I was your age, and then one of the kids said, "What year was it you were our age?" I said, "1957." He says, oh my gosh, you're older than my grandfather. so that's got to be my next title, is you're older than my grandfather.
Wow, you're really old. Yeah, always love that one. All right, well, I want to thank everybody for being here today. I want to thank Metro 3 for recording it for us. And if you have questions for Debbie after the show, please talk to her. Her book is back there, and I'm sure she would sign it for you. And so thank you, and have a good afternoon.